is put together 100% by volunteers giving up their time and money to make everything happen here. We just wanted to give them a lot of thanks today. Our star top artist, Jeff Carrell, and his friend, Jason Peltz and Bill Cable. Thank you for those guys doing all the artwork to make the star tops a reality. There's some things over the social room going on. One of our leads is Todd Chamberlain, who did the collector's showcase stuff over there. And you also see here, we've got Vader case pictures here. What we're doing this year is called the Vader case project. A lot like the Vader project you may have seen at past celebrations if you were there. We gave vintage Vader cases to a bunch of artists and had them go to town and make their creative changes to them. So these are all for a charity auction. So they're right over here, two doors down in room 210D. So go, even if you don't want to bid, go over there and look at them because they are far more impressive in person than even what these photographs reveal. I see a couple of people shaking their heads like, yeah, they're really cool. So go check them out. Also, Jason Perez, one of the artists I already mentioned, will be over there signing all day today. So if you want to get your star shot signed by one of the artists, you can head over there. There's some other cool things going on in the social room. You can pick up our scavenger hunt card, which has started today. So the scavenger hunt, you'll be looking for little stickers of action figures all around the convention. And the first person to complete the whole card and bring it back to the social room gets a pretty cool prize. And there will also be some second, third type prizes and stuff. We're giving away some licensees and donating some things. So if you want to win some stuff and have some fun doing it, go over there and get one of these cards, and they can give you more details over there about how exactly the whole thing works. We've got a new thing we're doing this year with live recording from around the convention. So if you have a smartphone, you can download an app called Hangwith. And if you follow Star Wars Celebration, you'll see a whole bunch of video posts from four or five different reporters, myself included, from all over the convention to share the cool things going around. We decided to do that this year partially for the people that couldn't make it. There were so many of our friends that can't be there, so we said, let's start this thing, and I bet people at the convention will probably like it. Maybe even give you some good ideas and things you want to see that you haven't hit yet. We've got some programs for sale. They're $4, and you can grab those on the way out, as well as little bins for your star tots if you want one of those. And finally, we've got an awards ceremony for the collecting track. We're going to be voting on the best Vader case, the best panel, things like that. Go to our Twitter feed if you want to check that out and even vote for some things. The Twitter feed is @C6CollectTrack. Yeah, that wasn't a mistake. It's C6 Collect Track, and that's, we had it last year and just didn't update it because we're lazy or something. I don't know. So, so go there and check out everything on the Twitter feed. Tommy in the back, it's all his fault. So, you know, but he does so much good work for our meeting social media, so we'll forgive him for this one. Yeah, give Tommy a round of applause. I don't know about you guys, but back when I was a kid, I've been a collector forever. I guess I just have the collector brain, and I was born with it. But the first things I ever started collecting, when you're a kid, the only thing you really collect are things that are free. So rocks get boring pretty quickly. So I moved into the two natural things a kid collects, stamps, right, number one, and two, coins. So you can always find a cool penny, or you look for your birth date on a penny, or a nickel, and you know, your parents are happy to give you a quarter and let you collect a quarter, so it's probably pretty lame, but as a 10-year-old or 6-year-old, I thought it was cool. But when I found out as an adult, because I had moved away from Star Wars before Kenner ever released any coins, so I didn't know about this until I was an adult, and I found out, wow, they had coins, and like, finally, a coin that's cool I can collect. So these guys are going to tell you all about that, so welcome them. We've got Will Grief, Gus Lopez, Mark Salotti, and James Gallo.
Hey everybody, right. Hey, welcome, and thanks. I really appreciate the great crowd we got here, and I just want to get everybody to give another round of applause for all the people sending stuff, CJ, Tommy, all the volunteers that kind of run things for the Star Toss. Everyone can just give them a round of applause. All right, so coins, yeah, Star Wars coins are great. There were 62 of them, and they're really cool, and you guys can go and get your Star Tops. Yeah, you got a whole presentation for you. And let's go through the overview here. We're going to go over some basics of Star Wars coins, basic coin collecting, so this will appeal to hopefully a lot of you that have never had any experience with collecting the coins. They're really fantastically made, and they're much higher quality than any of the like modern stuff that you guys might have seen recently in the past 10 years or so. The sculpting quality, the pure. So the basics is going to just go over the regular coins themselves. It's just more advanced collecting, talking a little bit of variations. And then we're going to talk about the prototypes and the pre-production process, kind of going through the gamut of how a coin was produced. And here on the left here, on your right here in the center, you can kind of get an example of exactly what went into just making each and every one of these coins. And you can imagine there's over 100 different coins made, and there had to be this many pre-production pieces made for all of those coins. Multiply all that stuff by over 100, and that's how many pre-production pieces there are. So we're going to go through the whole prototype process, and then we're going to talk about some recent events in coin collecting. So I'll hand it off to Mark and James, who are talking about some cases.
I'm going to apologize for my stranded accent, and also for a number of times I'll say aluminium instead of aluminum. Hopefully you'll catch on. So it's 1984, and there's other very strong toy lines like Transformers, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and Turtles. Kenner were a bit, you know, they weren't sure of the future of Star Wars. There was no Star Wars movie coming, of course. There was only the Ewok droid animated cartoon series. But they were determined. They knew they had a strong product and they were going to keep going with it. They were determined to get this slide.
What technical difficulties here? So I think pretty soon he's gonna obtain monarch status with respect to swag. I don't know if it's gonna be prince or king or what, but you're getting close up there.
I think he's gonna be cripple. All right, here we go. So they were really determined to put you on with their Star Wars line, you know, to advance really quickly. So they released their fourth, well, the next wave of release was Power of the Force card figures, where they selected characters from across the Star Wars trilogy, so it wasn't specific to any movie. And and they included a special Star Wars collector coin. Obviously, they saw before in the back of the cards. And here are the 62 coins that were sort of commercially available.
And then at the same time they were doing the Joyce Deluxe item releases, so there was 18 additional coins for those two lines. The golds, coins were detroit, and the lines they decided to do Deluxe for nine.
And these are a couple of very common variant coins that were commercially available. It's a Luke Stormtrooper with and without eyes. They're both equal numbers.
We get Kazadan with and without a dash. Very important. And then the last most important one is the 3PO. I actually have a sign-off sample where they specifically stated the artwork used as the regular Power of the Force coin, it's not the animated coin. So they actually approved both versions of the coin to be used in that packaging. And as many of you may know, they planned an additional line of both the George and Elon's figures, both of the core sales and the core show. They were canceled, however, the coins were produced in limited quantities as prototypes, so you can assemble a set of coins with a lot of searching and money.
Just jump in here real quick. On the system coins, it tells you that like a lot of just regular coin collectors don't even necessarily go after all these variations or anything like that. For the most part, there's a whole different types of coin collectors. There's some that might just collect the coins to go along with the figures, because they like how it goes along with the figure, and that's perfectly fine. There are others who want just the set of 62, right, the original set of 62 coins, and then, you know, collecting some of the Lopez coins and Ewoks coins, which is probably not at all secondary. It's next to it. It's probably not as popular as just going after the whole set of coins. You know, don't be unnerved by, hey, there's all these different variations of characters I've never seen. Because a lot of them are like really go after these, just go for the original 62 coins.
And usually, I mean, and a lot of collectors, all what they are going after. So then he starts trying to do a 62 coin set, and like a bunch of Elon set, and then they get into advanced stuff like variations or unreleased coins.
So most of you hopefully have seen that lovely sticker. That was actually applied in retail by the individual stores, which is why you'll see it on, you know, Return of Jedi cards, you'll see it on Empire Strikes Back cards, you'll see it on very rare games, on Star Wars cards. And that was basically how they used old product and kept advertising, you know, this new exciting thing that we're offering. That individual mailer up there is, if you could send away for a coin, and they would send you a gram coin in that small little mailer. If you were really determined and you were tired of trying to seek out all these coins that you could never find, you actually could send away a Kenner and you could get a full set for at least $25. Fortunately, not many people had the thoughts to do that. So the mailer envelopes were pretty difficult to find, but it was something that was available, but they just didn't advertise it as such.
Hey, on the mailer, I just want to talk about swag again one more time, because I just want to give a kudos out to Mark Huber, because his swag actually included a nice little mailer that looked exactly like the old mailer. What did he even say? I don't remember. What did it say in front of you? Who was addressed to Mark?
It was just addressed to the convention.
To the convention.
Yeah.
Addressed to Star Wars Celebration. So, good job.
Thank you.
Now, in Australia, it's all to apply, well, they supply these stickers to small retail outlets, and they apply them at retail. And at checkout, when you pay for your figure, you're able to collect your coin, and it's great because you're able to actually select which coin you wanted. There's a little trivial sync box for the coins, and we shook them out on the counter and we pick it out. So I did it in the reverse. I shook out everything I needed, then went back and bought the figures to match the coin that I wanted. So there were about 16 coins available through that way in Australia. And the Japanese toy coin, they actually glued a couple of coins to a card, and they shrink.
Mark, yeah,
I can't do this.
Can you just pronounce the name of that company?
Did I get that right? Did I close?
I have no idea.
Collectors have found about 7 different figures that were done this way. There must be more, but we recorded about 7 different ones. Because of the shrink wrap on the top so that the coin could be stolen, there was a cardboard back and forth sort of the figure being employed as the shrink wrap was put on. And if you punch holes, you can see there a little hole so that with the wood wrap there. and Kenner's intention was to re-release all the current figures on our postcards. So this is a famous photo from the catalog that has some unproduced figures essentially. And there was evidence that they were planning on, there's some coin variations and applicant text on the back that suggests that coin would be placed in more than one different figure. So that this say a large coin, for example, the text refers to the account as an unscrupulous text as I should write. But so that would go with certain different figures like boss and those that didn't have a specific coin. So we think this proof.
When Kenner began promoting the Carbon Force line at Toy Fair, they actually made these wonderful signs. These are all kind of one of a kind signs around the coins. And they were saved by the head of the New York sales office, also ran Toy Fair for Kenner, High Cat Line, who actually was visiting Celebration yesterday, because he now lives in Southern California. So he had saved these from old Toy Fairs when we introduced the line. And they're really cool signs. The Vader is a three-dimensional coin, large kind of foam coin, and then the Boba Fett and the two droids, Ewox coins, were also just there to, you know, really give prominence to this new premium added to the action figures. And so these are the kind of things collectors are just, you know, always trying to track down these kind of one-of-a-kind pieces.
Yeah, it's also interesting because, you know, it's such a huge investment in those displays, and like you said, they're so prominent, probably figured pretty prominent into or Toy Fair setup they had, but we never found a picture of the actual setup.
Right, and a lot of the early years in Toy Fair, there's actually very little photography. Certain years there is some photography, but you know, people didn't really preserve that part of the history, you know, people walking through the booth, but some of the pieces from the booths were saved.
Just to give an idea, those coins are huge. Like they're two or three times the size of the Star Dot, so they're very big, prominent displays.
I don't have a laser pointer or anything like that, but if you look at the Vader coin in the lower right-hand corner, you kind of see like a big little black rectangular image and a shiny coin, so that's a regular card figure sitting right next to that Vader coin.
So it's possible that there's not going to be any evidence because of the fight.
Yeah, possibly. Anyways, the Vader coin is about five.
And then in retail stores, Kenner made store displays to promote the action figures. Now what's interesting here is this is the header of a bin that was meant to hold the Power of the Force action figures. But you see that it really doesn't, it has the word action figures, but the coin, the Boba Fett coin, front and back, are shown prominently on the display. So you can see the coins were a big part of the rebranding of Star Wars around this new Power of the Force slogan banner that they had. Early on in the coin process, they actually had a few versions of the Proud Force coins as they're kind of working on the concept. So Will's going to get into this a little later in the presentation, but the first one on the top row is known as the pitch coin, and that's really the earliest version of the coins. And you can see the concept on it, for those very familiar with the coin line, it looks very different than the normal Power of the Force coins, because you have kind of a close-up of Luke's face and then, you know, kind of Luke holding the lightsaber, but both on the same coin, and the back is also very different. You have the X-Wing kind of taking up about half the coin reverse and a lot, you know, less text. So that was the first version of the coins. The second row shows a Luke X-Wing coin that now starts to have the appearance of the Power of the Force coins, but the diameter of the coin is much smaller than the normal Power of the Force coin, so it's done kind of as a smaller coin. And there are various variations of this coin on the back, different text, different versions of the small Yoda head that's on the back. These are the more common of those versions you can find relatively easily for a quote unquote prototype of the Power of the Force coin line. So a number of collectors, when they start to get into the coin prototypes, that's one of the first ones they find. And then the bottom one is called by collectors a Frosted Lando, but it really is kind of a coin that is struck twice by the dies to get just this really highly polished kind of look. And these were used in early mock-ups of the action figure packaging. You can see in a lot of internal Kenner photography these coins that it's only Lando that they struck this way that has this appearance. And there's some other kind of minor differences between that and the final Lando coin that they did. There's other unreleased coins. So there's a gold R2D2 coin. So they not only changed the color from the regular R2D2 coin, but they changed the logo on the back to, instead of the generic Star Wars logo, they went to the Power of the Force logo. This was, it's believed, is planned as a mail-away version of R2D2 that was a little different than the normal Power of the Force coin. There are a number of variations on the bottom. There's the first version of the Han trench coat coin, and you can see it actually says Han Solo. So they had a typo, and they had to fix his name. And then they're really minor once you get into here, like the sail skiff coin that's missing Star Wars along the top. The creatures coin's an interesting one. Quite a while back, I bought a bunch of these coins, and I had a few different creatures coins. I was just comparing coins. I noticed, hey, you know, one of these actually says cafes, and the other says cantinas on the back. And then it was like, lo and behold, we discovered a new variation. And so the cafe coin, which is the harder version of it, became one of these things that collectors are trying to find. There are a bunch of these other kinds of coins where they change the text on the back and become really sought after by collectors. Now, at the end, as they did the initial Power of the Force coins, as most of you probably are aware, they did these Power of the Force action figures. They had coins bundled with the action figures. As they were kind of, getting those into stores, they were planning another wave of the Power of the Force promotion. And what they were going to do is a mail-away offer for a coin album. And the idea is that you could put 18 of your coins in this album, and that the album would come bundled with this new coin, the 63rd coin, which was a gold coin that was a gold tone coin that was hands holding a lightsaber, similar to the Return of the Jedi poster. And it was supposed to be kind of this overarching, kind of Power of the Force coin representing the whole line, and you could only get it by mailing away for this album. But they never got to this point in the line, and so you can see kind of on the next slide, this is the kind of mock-up of how the 93 back action figure cards would look with this coin album and 63rd coin offer. So it's showing kind of different ways that the front and back would look. And the back of the action figure card actually added gap face onto it, so they brought the action figure line from 92 figures to 93 figures.
All right, so that's kind of a quick overview of basic and advanced coin collecting. And like I said, some people are really into it and go into trying to get every one of those different variations. And Gus and Mark have kind of been in a little competition over the years to try to do that, to see who's got the most coins or the most different variations. So some people just get really into these. Then there's kind of another branch that kind of gets into the pre-production process. And some of those variations can be considered pre-production, but I'm more talking about like how the coins were originally produced. And so, in short, they first made a drawing of what they wanted to have the coin look like. And once the drawing was done and approved, then they sent that drawing to a sculptor, and the sculptor would sculpt an image based on that drawing. And then that sculpt would essentially be copied and eventually turned into a die, and that die would be used to stamp out the coins. So the renderings or the artwork, you can kind of see the original, concept artwork for the Vader was on the left there, lower left-hand corner. And for whatever reason, he didn't like that. They didn't need the approval process. And for this particular coin, they actually just tossed the entire design and had them do it completely.
There are some similarities to the pigeon coin for Luke, where you had the face of the character and the full-bodied character. It's presumably one of the earliest concepts of where they went to.
So also kind of on these renderings, there were probably two different companies that were doing it. It wasn't Kenner that was actually sketching up the art. It was Kenner would often send out whatever work they wanted to do to various different places in Cincinnati or elsewhere. So the one on the left has a distinctly different look to it, and the one on the right, you can see where on the left they actually sketched out the text, and the one on the right they printed out the text and glued them onto each one of these presentation boards. So one of the things that we do, and obviously, maybe on an obvious
difference between these two images. On the left, we have the Death Star on that. Is maybe someone thought it was a Death Squad, or Death Star commander, which wasn't really called it, but we put a Death Star at the back of it. And then someone figured out, oh, these guys are supposed to be Star Destroyer commanders now, so we probably put a Death Star on that. So you might think that they would redo the whole thing, photocopy it, and then kind of change things around a little bit. But they actually had this stuff on vellum. They had it sketched out on vellum. And what they would do is the artist would just cut out the piece that he didn't like and then put a new piece of vellum on there and then sketch it out on the vellum. So just one example. I got a couple other examples here of some change around the experience. That probably turned out too well. But the man ran, you can see on the final point is actually on the left, and on the right you have a scale large point. And the man was interesting because on the points they actually referred to it as odds. So it wasn't even a man of man. His original name was odds. It just like was. So I thought that's very appropriate for having someone from odds. So thank you very
much. Sam, you look like
No. No, you don't look anything like that. So some of the other art boards that turned up actually didn't even have real artwork attached to them. They were just photocopied renderings. But the original artwork for at least the second series droids and Ewoks were probably sketched over from basically Lucasfilm approved renderings of the actual image. So you can see here that that's basically just a photostat of the chitter pasted up onto that board. But at some point, they did a sketch over probably like a cell that they had for animation, like a model cell. And then basically added maybe a little bit of grass in the background or something like that. I'm trying to add to the So once they did the rendering, then they sent it to the sculptor. And the sculpting was probably done in multiple different places. So it was probably sent out to some people that Kenner would often do. But some of the sculpting was done in-house at Kenner. Some of the sculpting was done in plaster. Some was done in wax as well. And why one person would use wax or plaster, I don't know. Some were done in clay first and then transferred to wax. It was basically up to the particular sculptor how they would do it. Is there any comments on this one?
Yeah, I mean, this was typical in all the toy process that we let, in the sculpting phase, we let the sculptor choose the medium that they prefer, and it's easier to have them work where they're comfortable to get the same end product than try to conform some standard way to sculpt.
So the sculptor actually, I mentioned there's 100 characters times all this pre-production process here. The sculptor probably the toughest thing to find in the respective production process, just because they're fragile. Plaster and some of them didn't survive just the prototyping process. So after the sculpt is made, then you got all these big giant circular discs next to the sculpt that you guys can see in the front. So first they make a resin hard copy of the sculpt, and they would do that by basically applying a bunch of resin, but they wouldn't want the resin to stick to this plaster, so they put a mold release. So sometimes they'll leave the sculpt kind of clean stuff on, or even the hard copy. And then they would make another positive image that coin collectors, vintage Star Wars coin collectors, kind of refer to as soft copies. Generally, we refer to it as rubbers. And then they would make another negative copy. And it had to be negative to basically use as a tool. But what, why that extra step? Good question, and to tell you the truth, there were two mints involved. One was up in Minneapolis, and one was in Cincinnati. One of those mints wanted to have a slightly curved appearance to the tooling master, because that's how they did their dies. They wanted the dies to be a little bit rounded. So it's a little bit of a curve to the final tooling master right on the end for any of the coins that were produced in Cincinnati. For the mint up in Worldwide, up in Minneapolis, which is Worldwide Mint, they wanted it flat. So actually on the backs of all Worldwide Schooling Masters, it says flat, or not all, but it says flat Googling.
What's cool about all these steps is that if you go prior to recent years where a lot of this stuff is advanced with digital technology, this is how all sorts of coins were made, not just the Star Wars coins. I mean, even currency, commemorative coins, anything that was kind of made out of mints anywhere in the world, they were using a very similar process to how Kenner made the Proud of the Force coins.
So with that, maybe we can segue this. That's a soft copy. And you guys can, if you want and you're interested, you can wander up here later and take a look at these. I'd ask them to not touch any of them because some of them are fragile. And also don't want to use that. Please walk along.
Who's going to wrap the words on the thing? You'll buy a ticket for a dollar at the door.
No, actually, every ticket is $1,000.
If you have a hard copy tape under your seat.
That's a reference to that. So throughout all this process, every single step of the way, they would have to send it to Lucasfilm for approval. And it was probably not as tedious as it is now from what I've heard talking to certain folks, but back in the day, they would still have to send stuff to Lucasfilm to approve it. So first they would send the rendering itself for approval, and if they didn't like it, they would say, make corrections, do this. And that's probably how a lot of the changes happened in the rendering. So I showed you that Star Destroyer Commander where they said, oh, this should be the Death Star, it should be the Star Destroyer's effect. So, and I heard stories about kind of how Kenner would interact with their contractors, and they were actually pretty rude. Like I've heard stories where the Kenner guys would basically had their renderings left or their artwork just thrown back at them and said, this is okay, we don't want this crap. So it was pretty harsh process in general. I don't know what the level of stressor was, but that's kind of just one of the little stories I got when I was talking to some of these folks. And then this one here, this one is basically showing a shot of the hard copy. So the renderings on the left, where this one's actually the Darth Vader one. So I don't know if you guys can read that back, but it says Lord of Sith, not Dark Lord. So if you remember, on the one on the lower left corner, it's a Dark Lord on the bottom. And then they want to say Dark Lord, they said Lord of Sith. And then it says, pose of Vader looks wimpy. Review lightsaber pose to reflect stronger active pose. Helmet okay. And then they did the hard copy, and the hard copy, I can't read it on this angle, but yeah. So that first one was approved with changes for the rendering. So then on the hard copy, it was actually disapproved, so you can put it in the right corner. I can't really read that too well, but anyways. And I was able to find a letter that was sent to from the sculpting department at Kenner off to one of the contract workers that was doing the sculpt. And just kind of showing the hassle that it was with Lucasfilm. You guys can't read that. It says, the process of getting design approval from Lucasfilm for the rendering was painful. It is extremely important that we make every effort possible on the sculpting of the Imperator. So the Darth Vader coin was apparently one of the important ones. And that might be why that was chosen as one of the toys there.
As a collector, this is one area where you can really geek out, finding paper trails on the approval process that you have from Kenner people or these subcontractors, and then trying to piece together what happened at each step, why did they do various changes. But it's one of these things that we're still learning as we meet people, and we say, yeah, can you just get your paperwork for us? We love that stuff, and we go through it and try to find all this information.
So this is just a shot of some more paperwork, and we're talking about paperwork. This is you can't really read the dates on it, but this is how they were basically tracking every single one of these characters and every single one of these coins on where it was in the approval process. And you can kind of see there's an organized one, and on the right there's kind of a less organized one that was just whoever was taking notes on what particular meeting. It was a long period of time. It was months and months to go through to get these to actual production. So on this sheet, again, you can see this is pretty organized, right? lots of notations on it. Well, one interesting note on this little document is it shows under one of the assortments, and maybe you can't read it in the back there, but one of the coins that they had planned was Garden, because they have a figure planned as well, the Garden coin. You can see that it's actually crossed out in blue, and then they wrote the Yakis in the corners. So they changed the Garden figure to Yakis. That's just kind of one of the pieces of evidence that shows that, yeah, that's what they were thinking, that's what they were doing. In addition, this actually shows some of the basically breakdowns of some of the assortments of the figures. And again, a lot of you probably don't really much care about this, but again, on the lower right-hand corner there, you just zoom in on that there, and you can see that that's basically the number of figures that they were planning on making for those Power Force figures. And each one of those numbers, so packout ratio 1-3-5-6, for the groups 1 and 2 on the left. So you can see Darth Vader was in group 2, and that was at number 3. So they were planning on making 500,000 Darth Vader figures. So they needed the appropriate number of coins to go along with that. So that basically equates to probably the number of coins that were at least ordered for each one of those characters. And the lower one there, the quota for the 93630 assortment is 2 mm, so that's 2 million. So that was probably the total number that they were ordering from Hong Kong's 2 million, and that would be the total number that they were ordering for the coins. But that's every different character. And those are the ones that actually didn't really make it to production. And if you look, again, right there. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, you can see how, though, like number one for the quota for 93630, there were probably only 42,000 of those coins ordered versus, you know, 833,000 coins or 1 million coins for level 6. The one of the number 6 assortment packets is like Luke Stormtrooper. So there are probably like a million Luke Stormtrooper coins that were made. Whereas like the skip coin was probably in, you know, one of these other assortments, and that was, you know, 42,000 or 83,000. So that probably explains why there are much fewer certain coin than others. Alright, so I mentioned there are two from each mints, Worldwide Mint, Osborne Coinage. Worldwide Mint is in was in Osborne Coinage. So there's my I shouldn't say it, but some type of eating grin in front of Osborne Coinage there. So I got, you know, I had the rare opportunity to actually go visit the mint that created some of the coins. And then the lower left corner, that's a picture of the mint in Minneapolis that was Worldwide Mint. And now Worldwide Mint has been defunct since the 90s. So Worldwide Mint, Minneapolis, Minnesota. The founder and owner was Ron Jay, and he basically had a whole bunch of these prototypes. He was a train collector, collected vinyl trains. So he had that collector mentality. We're talking about the collector mentality where, you know, you want to collect things or put away forever. So he knew about that. He didn't particularly collect Star Wars stuff, but he collected trains, and he knew one day someone was going to be collecting this stuff. So he saved all the stuff that had been sent to him from Kenner and saved all the dimes. They had originally been, you know, making whatever other coins they would make these gold foil stamps, they were making the Coca-Cola Budweiser displays, that kind of thing. They were just making all sorts of foreign currency. Oh yeah, yeah, those are guys, yeah, made foreign currency too, so precious metal stuff they would do. So the building selections, so this was actually a collage of photos that was hanging in his garage. And if you kind of zoom in on that, that was Worldwide Mint. That's where the coins were made back in the day. And there's some other pictures. And some of these other pictures are basically really good anonymization. So we went out there, cold, freezing snow, phone calls about 2-3 years ago. And we went to visit the building. And so now it's selling for a lot. If anyone wants to. So Worldwide Mint, so, you know, they're credited for producing this first group pitch point. And the collectors call it a pitch point. In reality, it was not referred to as a pitch point or gasoline. It was referred to as a pitch point. So they came up with the concept of, hey, we're making this point. Star Wars is big and popular. This is like when Return of the Jedi was coming out. Maybe we can capitalize it and sell this to a company that's making all the Star Wars figures as like a stock or something. And they were even thinking about doing gold or silver coins. So they produced this Luke Jedi coin just kind of on their own. And Ron sent one of the sales reps down to Cincinnati to try to pitch it. That's kind of where that this coin actually might be. CJ's responsible for it. Right, so it's a pitch point. One second for the next slide. So it's really, to most people, it's considered like the first Power Force coin because it was used to pitch the line to Kenner. How they got the idea of like what to use for imagery actually came out of this magazine, poster magazine. And this is something you can kind of find online. And if you look inside the magazine, there's like a picture of Luke. Obviously he's flipped around because when the guy was engraving the die, this coin actually didn't go through all this process I was talking about. So they also have these coin engravers that they actually hand engrave the die just by looking. So it's an artist who engraves stuff directly into the coin. So he was looking at that image on the left, and so it would be reversed because the dies would be reversed. That's why it's flipped around. But you can tell that that's exactly the image that he used, and it came from that poster magazine. That poster magazine that I showed, that's the one that Ron actually sent and said, hey, this is going to come. Interestingly, though, Ron also had these file photos, and that one on the lower left actually matches pretty close to that same image. And the one on the right, you can kind of imagine that his foot is that same foot, because on that photo, the foot is actually a circle. So that engraver was probably using those as reference too, but that doesn't make sense because those file photos were sent from Kenner. So really, to me, the story is that it was engraved based on the photos in that magazine, but then these file photos came out from there. So there's probably talk back and forth between them at some point in time that it just doesn't involve. I don't think you guys have any thoughts on that. But anyways, that's a picture of the die. And then the next one, that's also pictured in the magazine. You can see basically that's matched up. We've been into this like 40 minutes. Any questions on anything? I know we're not finished, but any questions on anything that we're going over? You guys are getting tired, I know. We're getting close. It's close. The talks are coming. The talks are coming. Yeah, so another interesting thing that had. So Osborne also had, they had made a smaller Luke X-Wing coin. The smaller Luke X-Wing coin is also thought to be kind of one of the first prototype coins. So Osborne made it in this particular size, and what's also interesting is with these renderings, Kenner sent a sample of the Osborne coin to Worldwide and said, hey, well, this is kind of what we want the coin to look like, except for bigger. So it sounds like Kenner had already sent Worldwide Mint and started things with Osborne, which is probably what happened. And talking to Ron, he wasn't really sure why Kenner even came back to him, but Kenner was probably afraid of some kind of lawsuit because Ron came up with the idea, and then they decided, oh, we better share the wealth with this guy, otherwise they might sue. So this is just a shot of some blueprints that were sent to Ron as far as dimensions and the specifics. So Worldwide Mint had another step in the process, which I didn't mention here, because I didn't bring the text itself. So the text for all the coins and the dies, they use this dipole process to make the text. The image itself was more important than the text, so they were very specific about the image, so they wanted that sculpted to be a three-dimensional image. text didn't matter so much. So they made these dipoles that are basically a photochemical process where you can see on this the back rendering on the table here, basically they took that and then they projected this on the dipole, and the dark patches basically faded away because that DuPont had some chemical process that they figured out that can make that happen. And they used those dipoles to tool the dye directly. Osborne is a little different. That's another picture. And this is just some stuff I found online about the dipole making process. And then again, the tooling aid was used to cut the dye. Now, on the most of these tooling aids were made by Kenner, and then Kenner sent the tooling aid, and they also sent the renderings, because he needed the renderings for reference to make the dipoles, right? So he happened to have the renderings, the tooling master, and all the dyes for the characters. But one of the coins, for whatever reason, Kenner didn't send the negative tooling master. They sent a positive diacast lanolin. You can see that on the right, the image might not come up that well, but that green stuff is diacast. And this is a type of resin that we use. So Ron couldn't use that to make the dye because then it would mean you can't tool a negative into things that will stamp positive. So he had to make his own tooling master, and that's basically the only one that was found that was on that. So positive dye cast tooling master. So what do I need? So Gus and I were lucky enough to land this collection. These are just some pictures for that collection. That's all the dyes, basically about half of the powder promise coins. There's a shot of all the tooling masters there. One looks a little bit different than the other. Actually, it looks a little bit different. All right, and there's a shot of some red. You want to talk a little bit about that?
One of the great things is Ron actually saved the rendering of all the coins that he was working on. So that was a unique thing because the other half of the coin set. It's been much harder to find those original renderings, and so that was one of the unique things about what he had said. Because prior to Ron selling some of these weren't, no collectors really had examples of these pieces, and so that was kind of one of the great things about that find.
There's some more pictures of the renderings.
Most of them are sketch and pencil, a lot of detail. They have.
This picture actually shows a little bit better that you can see the ones that were actually hand done on vellum, and the second series Joys and Ewoks stuff was actually photos that was done. Alright, so Osborne coins. Osborne is still around, they're still making coins. They actually just made some coins, right? And it's basically America's oldest private man, that's their kind of thing. And there's his dad. So that's that's a picture of the first Osborne coin. It was probably the Luke X-wing, and on the left there you can see it's smaller. So that's the Luke X-wing prototype coin, and then also show the appropriate die that goes along with that. So the bigger one on the right, that's the one that actually came apart here. So you know how you tell which ones from what mint? I don't know if you guys can see that at all, but you can see there was a little bit different process as far as coins themselves when they were stamped. And for whatever reason, Ron wanted to make sure that his coins didn't have a cutting edge, and he burnished the edges. So all the worldwide mint coins will have a little bit of burnished edge. All the Osborne coins will have a little bit of sharp edge. Yeah. So just briefly, one of the big differences between Osborne and Worldwide was that they didn't use that dipole process; they used the zinc plate. So a lot of the zinc plates turned up back in the day from Osborne, and those were specifically used for the text. The images on there are specifically for reference. And I mentioned that before with the tooling master had curved appearance, is the, you know, the little shot of the tooling master for the Osborne points had that curved appearance. And the, this is Osborne. This is the machine that stamps out the coins. You can kind of see how they fit into the machine. And then, so also, actually, this was just about a year ago. We had the opportunity to go into Osborne, and we were lucky enough to purchase all of Osborne sets in the vault. That's a picture of the drawer that they were sitting in the vault. I mean, that's how they had the dice set up. Oh, an unusual die in the book. All right, so that is stupid. This is just some pictures of some of the dies. So things evolve throughout vintage Star Wars collecting hobby. And very, you know, new information comes to light at various different points in time. So I just wanted to kind of cover a couple of different things that have come to light relatively recently. So in the past, there'd be these dyes out there that were taller, and they also came with positive image that were referred to as the hub, because the hub is basically they can take a die and stamp it into another piece of metal rod in a special hubbing machine, and then they give it a hub to produce another die. So there are these
gray hubs.
It's just his accent, but it's always gets me. So these other dyes that had been sold in the past, collected in the past. Unfortunately, you know, everyone's got an opinion about everything, but my personal opinion is these probably weren't used back when they were taller ones. The ones that we pulled out of Osborne were basically fit into the machine. They looked like they had been used multiple times and were sitting in those parts of all. These other ones that were sold on a secondary market in the past didn't have those same qualities.
In essence, what's happening, you know, about 15 years ago, as collectors started to approach these companies like Osborne, the people working at the companies, you know, there's huge dollar signs there as, wow, I can make a lot getting all these byproducts in the production process. And so they these hubs and some dyes surfaced around that time from Osborne. But it turns out now that we have more information, you know, those aren't the actual dyes used for the vintage Kenner line. And there's a lot of evidence pointing to that actually they were constructed in the 90s and possibly even constructed for collected to be something sold to collectors but posed as something original. We don't know for sure.
It's also possible that they were made as part of the, you know, the re-release of the coins in the late 90s. We didn't really talk about that today, but Kenner re-released some of the coins in the late 90s. They called them Millennium, not to be confused with worldwide mint, but it was Millennium minted coins. And those Millennium minted coin dies have a different appearance than all the older dies. So another thing that was kind of brought to light relatively recently was there were probably multiple runs specifically of the Osborne coins, and no one really, you know, some people had suspected things one way or the other. In short, there was a large number of coins that was recently found that included some coins that we knew were modern origin because they went along with these millennium minted coins that came in the 90s. I did copyright, marking was missing. So we knew that a lot of coins, at least those coins, had to be a modern origin, but they went along with all the coins. And it happens to be every single one of the coins that were corresponded to each one of the dies that we pulled out of the Osborne vault. So in kind of various discussions and various different forums and talking to various different people, it came to light that there were probably three different runs of modern coins in different weights, and there was one that was a thinner coin. So the thinner coin actually weighed a little bit less than the other coins. So you can put it on the scale, and all those thinner coins ended up being about 3.9 grams. And then there was a thicker coin that also had come one other one that recently came out that basically had the correct thickness, correct gauge, and the approximately the same one. So there are Osmo coins out there that are a little bit suspect, and it's very hard to tell what the difference is. So I guess the caution is, especially if you're new and getting into coin collecting right now, be cautious about spending a lot of money on risky coins without knowing exactly what's in. And one of the things that doesn't necessarily equate to, yes, a legitimate coin is if it's AFA graded, then it's not necessarily equate to, yes, trust it. But then I just wanted to kind of make that make everybody aware. So that's kind of a quick overview of basic advance and some of the more complicated and boring stuff that I went over. But in conclusion, I just wanted to kind of to emphasize that coins are a great thing to collect. I love them. Otherwise, I wouldn't be up here talking to you. All these guys up here love them. I'm sure there's several guys in the audience that as well just love the coins. Two different mints produce them, Osborne and Blind Mints. And various, you know, I've touched on some various coins. Just be careful. Just be careful. So, I actually just wanted to interrupt the talk and all this together. But, you know, earlier I mentioned that these two guys have been competing for a long time for, you know, who's got the best coin collection. Actually, James had kind of been keeping track of who's got the highest ranking of a coin and who's this and who's that. And so it was funny. So they're trying to figure out, like, who's the real monarch? You know, we're talking about monarchs. You know, with Tommy out there, the Duke of Swag out there. So we have a rare occasion today where two monarchs will be christened today. And I'd like one of my assistants to come up to the stage here. I'd like to announce the crowning of the new coin emperor and the king of coins.
This is hot.
Okay.